Alrighty. How's it going, everybody? Welcome to King of the Castle. This fun little game here is a, it's a bit of a political simulator, you could say. It's a game where pretty much I, as the streamer, will be playing today as a Morgan, the Queen, Morgan of the Morgan Dynasty. And we are going to be playing on Twitch. Alrighty. Let's see here. Install it. Yep, I should have that already active. So, we get to pick our factions. Let's see here. Let's go ahead and grab Barons, Chiefs, and Patricians. Sounds fun to me. So, for those of you who are already in chat, go ahead and type the exclamation point join, and then he, she, or they, whichever your preferred pronoun is. And I'll go ahead and start getting people sorted into the various noble groups. CC, don't do that. Hey, leave that alone, please. Alrighty, we've got one chief of the north. We've got Glenn, 149. Hey, let's go. We got people loading in. Sounds good. Let's see about maybe moving chat for this. Currently slightly overlaid over the picture of Queen Morgan of the Morgan Dynasty. Alright, so we've got a Baron, a Chief, and a Patrician, which means we can officially begin and we can let more people filter in as time goes. Alright, I'll go ahead and get things rolling, just that way we are getting it underway. Alrighty. So you all should be able to see a little crown icon sort of on the left-hand side of your screen, sort of near the top. If you hover that, it should tell you some information about yourself, such as what faction you are in and how much personal wealth you have. Personal wealth is used to use it during auctions to buy buildings. If I take a look over here at the noble list, we've got the Baron Mystic Kelpie, the Chiefs Glenn 149 and Fugo 2104, and the Patrician Sonic Hedgehog. Oh wait, hey, how's it going, Jorg? You can join at any time with the exclamation point join and then your preferred pronoun. Alright, so let's see here. Council introduction. Now that you are the Queen, your first duty is to meet with the Council of Nobles. Your nobles hail from across the kingdom, the wintry north, the wealthy coast, and of course, the bleak march. Let's go ahead and introduce ourselves to the Chiefs of the North.
Good luck with the days ahead, Your Highness. You'll need it, dealing with us lot.
Thank you, Chief Fugo 2104.
A pleasure, Your August Majesty. I hope to see our kingdom prosper and grow wealthy under your reign.
Thank you, Lord Patrician Sonic Hedgehog 420.
Hail and well met, Your Highness. Under your leadership, we'll whip this kingdom into shape.
Thank you, Baron Mystic Kelpie. That, the introductions are done. The council hall immediately fills with raised voices as the nobles argue with each other and demand your favor. You sigh and sit back. Is this what the council is like? No wonder your father told you to avoid the throne at all costs. Alright, so we got a couple other events. So let's go to the coronation.
Your Majesty, I've scheduled your coronation to take place in a week's time. Shouldn't I be giving the orders now?
Of course, Your Majesty, but to delay any longer would make the nobles restless. And when nobles get restless, they take their daggers and look for the nearest back.
They wouldn't dare!
You should pay more attention to your history books, Your Majesty. The nobles are always plotting something. As is tradition, the council will decide what happens at your coronation.
Of course.
Shall we call the nobles in?
All right. So we are at the first vote of the game. So if I want to, I can say veto an option or put a monarch vote on one option. But you will be able to vote using, I believe it's exclamation point, and then it'll be the corresponding letter. So it'll be A, B, C, or D. We either host a lavish parade with jugglers and fountains of wine, force the commoners to swear a blood oath, throw the queen into the river, or troops shall bear the queen through the streets atop a shield. And we will go ahead and start the vote. All right, so it's exclamation point vote, A, B, C, or D. See, we got the patricians wanting to force the commoners to swear a blood oath. I like it. I see. I love democracy. I love the republic. What kind of coronation should be held for the new queen? Force the commoners to swear a blood oath. Chat? Is there something you'd like to tell me? The common citizens of the capital are lined up in a winding queue that loops along a dozen streets. One by one, they are brought before your throne, bowing and scrapping or scraping. After a bit of prodding from your watchmen, each citizen slices their palm and smears their blood on your boots, swearing their eternal loyalty. No amount of scrubbing will save your shoes after this. The last monarch to hold a blood oath ceremony was King Timion the Mad, who also once declared war on the color blue. The peasants muttered darkly that another tyrant now sits the throne. I see we've got a couple new people in chat. How's it going? You can join at any time with exclamation point join and then your preferred pronouns. All right. Our last event for this season, the Path to Victory.
Your Majesty, when you die, how do you hope the kingdom will remember you?
Let's see here. How are we looking? Our military's pretty mighty with the barons and the chiefs. Though the patricians leave something a little to be desired. Peacekeeper. Mother of the nation farming. Let's see here.
Let's be the greatest queen who ever lived. Morgan the First. I see. You're the type who likes to build lots of statues of yourself, aren't you? I suggest, over the next few years, you focus on improving your authority as much as possible. Once you have an heir, I will return to discuss how your ambition is progressing. Good luck, Your Majesty.
Alright, and so with that, we are to the end of the first season. It's time for a scheme. Barons, this one is going to be you.
Ulrika of the GCS 6587 bloodline, legendary marcher elder, stands before a blazing hearth, roaring with arms outstretched. When have the barons of the march backed down from a fight? Never! I know you'll do whatever it takes to put me, your rightful queen, on the throne!
All right, so it is now your vote. Marcher barons,
What is your goal? What is your scheme? So there's raise authority, lower others' military, or lower the general stability. What's it going to be? We got to vote for modernization from GCS. All right. Voting has closed. The barons plan to modernize the kingdom's army in such a way that it's totally under their control. First, they must prove the military is in need of reform. To advance their scheme, the barons must lower the other region's military to a combined total of 10 or less in 4 seasons. So they've got 4 seasons to lower military, basically. Oh, hey, how's it going, Mimir? Alright. Heth of the Glen 149 clan, infamous northern rascal, stands precariously on a longhouse crossbeam, spitting as they speak. Chiefs of the North, we all know that I should be on the throne, not this imposter Queen Morgan. How do we make that happen? So, chiefs, I'll go ahead and pull up the noble list. Glen 149, Fugo 2104, how are you going to put your puppet Heth on the throne? An uprising, intimidation, or hornblower? I'm doing pretty all right, Vimmer. You can join in and get sorted into one of the houses with exclamation point join, and then he, she, they, depending on what you'd like. Also, Fugo, it is exclamation point vote, and then space, and then the letter you'd like to vote for. So I can delay it to let you get your words in, if you'd like. I forgore. Alrighty. Give him a little more time. Fair enough. Alright. Intimidation. Alright, so we've now got Vimir. Welcome. You are a Baron of the March. Alright, so what scheme should the Chiefs pursue? Intimidation. Their goal is to raise stability. The Chiefs plan to hold the Queen hostage in her own palace. First, they must lull the spymaster into a false sense of security. To advance their scheme, the Chiefs must raise stability to 5 or more in 4 seasons. Narilla of the Sanic Hedgehog 420 family, charismatic business mogul, scribbles with a well-used quill on a hardwood desk, muttering in frustration. Fellow patricians of the coast, my claim to the throne is far more legitimate than that of Queen Morgan. Something must be done. So, Sanic Hedgehog 420, you are our only current patrician. How would you like to put Narilla of your own bloodline onto the throne? You got subterfuge, lower stability. Doppelganger, lower own defiance. Okay. What scheme should the patricians pursue? Doppelganger. The patricians plan to swap the real queen for a perfect doppelganger. First, they must gain the trust of the spymaster. To advance their scheme, the patricians must keep their defiance at 4 or less for 4 seasons. Alright, so we've got Ulrika, the bastard offshoot, Heth, the ambitious vassal, and Narilla, the questionable claimant. Alright. Let's see here. This will be interesting. Yeah, warning, the monarch currently has no heir. It's fine, I don't plan to die just yet. Alright, so by royal decree, we can tweak the laws governing how the council votes. We can't pass more than 3 laws at once, and only 1 may be used per vote. So I have a few options here. I've got Monarch's Golden Choice, where if you vote for the option that I mark, you will gain 500 personal wealth, which can be used to buy buildings
to further your own ends later. There's also Royal Gamble, which is if I have everyone essentially vote on my option that I select with it, I get 600 into my treasury. Treasury is different than personal wealth. Personal wealth is for each one of you nobles. The treasury is the kingdom at large. And then there's reverse voting. Nobles must vote for their least favorite option, and the option with the least votes will pass. And honestly, reverse voting is just so delicious. All right. Let's see here. A new trend. Lord Patrician Sanic Hedgehog 420 is here to see you, Your Majesty. He wants to sell you a crab. Of course he does. It's the latest trend along the coast, Your Majesty. The Patricians have started keeping a species of jeweled crab as a fashionable pet. The creatures are so rare that one can now sell for as much as a mansion. Very well. Send him in.
Thank you for seeing me, Your Majesty. I know the price is steep, but I assure you, these crabs will only go up in value.
So we can either buy the box of crabs, turn this fool away, or what a waste of everyone's time. I'll make the sale of jeweled crabs illegal. Buy the crabs? It's a crab. Ooh. Ooh. Lord Sanic, you didn't mention that the crab danced. Okay. A dancing jeweled crab? I'll buy it. Counting out your gold, Lord Patrician Sanic Hedgehog 420 assures you that you will not regret the purchase. Alright. Let's see here. I need an honor guard.
Your August Majesty, I have a brilliant idea.
Why don't you hold a battle royale to choose your honor guard?
If you let us host it in the coast, I'll even pay for it. The spectacle will boost our economy massively. And of course, I'm confident the coastal gladiators will win.
Your Majesty, this is pointless. Why don't you just choose your honor guard and have done with it?
Hold a battle royale. It's minus 750 wealth. Wealth is not treasury. So you know what? Let's do it.
Marvelous. I'll begin organizing the event at once.
Lord Patrician Sanic Hedgehog 420's wealth has decreased. But I am not going to be picking my honor guard. A week later, you receive word that the battle royale is due to begin. Held, of course, in the coastal arena. You travel down to spectate, along with the horde of murder fans. Along with a horde of murder fans from across the kingdom. Trade is now dominant.
Welcome, one and all. Today's competitors are Northern Warrior Heroes, Champion Gladiators from the coastal arena, and the Baron's battle-hardened veteran soldiers.
Who will you support, Your August Majesty?
Let's see here. I suppose it would only be... You know, I've done a lot here. I've bought crabs, you know, dancing jeweled crabs, and I have allowed the patricians to so generously host, but I think I may need to go ahead and put my bid somewhere else. Also, I am going to move chat so that way you appear in a more readable corner as opposed to over top of every lord that appears. Give the veterans a job. Let's see. All right, you know what? I'll support the vets.
I think our coastal gladiators will surprise you. Watch the fight.
Here we go. The bell rings. The marcher soldiers charge like a bull, his sword already swinging. The northern warrior blocks it with his battle axe, grunting with the effort. The northern warrior scarcely has time to catch his breath before the gladiator is also upon him, roaring with mad laughter. Sparks fly as blades clash.
The three fighters dart back and forth, almost too fast for your eye to follow. Once, twice, a blade finds its mark. Blood sprays, and finally, someone stands victorious. It's the Marcher veteran, his scarred face speckled with blood. His opponents lie dead at his feet.
Let's go, vets.
Depths below. They must have cheated, or we just got unlucky. Regardless, you have the honor guard you wanted, Your Serene Highness.
Thank you, Lord Patrician Sanic the Hedgehog 420. Alright, now it's time for the songsters. We got you, Rose. Thank you. I appreciate it. The march sends their best, clearly. I appreciate it. Alright, Chief Glenn 149.
Your Majesty, a bard who calls herself the Songstress has been making waves in the north. Her performances are attracting huge crowds, so huge that there have been brawls and stampedes, people push closer to the stage. There have been no deaths, yet, but it's only a matter of time. With every concert, the riots get worse. What can we do to nip this in the bud?
So, chat, you will get to vote on what you would like to do. So you can either ban her from performing, ensure her shows have adequate security, invite her to the palace for a private show, or this is not a matter for the council's attention. And let's see here. I'm going to veto banning her from performing because I find that funny. So here you go. Have at it, my nobles. Let your will be known.
Ooh, it's a close one.
Ooh. Alright. Welcome, Killer Man. Lord Patrician Killer Man. I didn't notice you sneak in. Alright, we will ensure her shows have adequate security. Armed guards are assigned to keep the peace during the songstress's shows, but you soon receive reports that the guards themselves are joining in with the riots. It's a bloodbath. Dozens of soldiers are killed, and even more civilians. Yet by all accounts, the songstress's performances are more popular than ever. Alright, military has gone down too strong in the north. What is going on? Yeah, this songstress, she's crazy. Alright, that's the end of that season on Throne of Games. So, welcome to the auction. So how this works is you all have personal wealth. So you will be able to type... Only the two highest funded buildings are going to be built. So you use the command !fund XY, where X is the letter of the building you want to build, and Y is the amount you all want to give. We can see our richest nobles over on the right, and I'll pull up the noble list so that way you can all see your personal wealths. And begin. This is all on you, whatever you would like to build. Oh, we got 1,000 coming out for the stadium. We got 500 coming out for the library for the chiefs. Remember your schemes that you're trying to achieve and try to get buildings that will help such things. If it's something like stability, that is a kingdom stat, so that affects me. If it is something that is, say, farming or military, that affects your, well, the specific region that it's being built in. So Deer Park would hurt the Baron's farming, for example. Alright. Wow, it is between D and F from the looks of it. There was some coming out for C for the cathedral, but people are not having it. Time is up. Buildings funded. Let's see here. There's the library, which is giving a bonus to stability. The biggest contributor was Baron Vimmer. And then there was also the stadium, which was funded by Lord Patrician Sanic Hedgehog 420. All right. And that is the end of the season. Okay. Let's see here. Finding a spouse. In the twisty passages of the castle, you can avoid your advisors, the nobles, even the spy master. But there is one person you can't avoid. Your mother. Alaruk TV, hey, thank you for the follow. I appreciate it. And ladies and gentlemen, that is our 30 follower goal, Matt. Let's go. Hell yeah. That said, getting back to it. There's one person you can't avoid. Your mother.
Why haven't you found a spouse yet? It's been almost a year. I've been busy, Mom. You'd better find the time. Don't worry. I'll take the liberty of finding eligible candidates. What's your preference? Men, women, or do you not mind?
Well, we are trying to create an heir, so we need ourselves a man.
Excellent. I'll send out messengers to the most influential noble families in the kingdom. Let's see what they have to offer.
Thank you, Mom. Mom, I'm real busy. I'm being a queen and shit. I'm trying to be the greatest queen who ever lived.
Devotion.
Chief Glenn 149 has come to us again.
Your Majesty, ignore everything I said about the songstress. I was completely wrong.
I hired her for a private performance to see what all the fuss was about, and by Oddhild's horn, I've never heard anything so beautiful. What is that melody? I was so moved, I immediately gave her all my money and the keys to my lodge.
Wait, what?
Yes, I'm living in the servants' quarters now, but it was worth it to hear her sing. You simply must invite her to the palace for a performance.
Your Majesty, this is deeply suspicious. We need to do something.
Alright, so we can either invite the songstress to the palace for a private show, order the spymaster to investigate this phenomenon, ban her music, or send an assassin to get rid of her permanently. And I'm going to veto actually having her come to the palace. I don't trust that. I don't want to give over the keys to the kingdom to her. All right. Up to you, chat. What are we doing? Let's see here. We got the chiefs fighting amongst themselves, not voting for the same thing. Lord Patrician Killerman voting to order the spymaster to investigate. Patricians voting together while the chiefs are split. No input from the Marcher Barons whatsoever. Not a single one of them. No Reds voted.
Investigator? Absurd! The songstress has done nothing wrong.
Defiance is now aloof. Don't worry, Your Majesty. I'll get to the bottom of this.
All right. And now, over in the march, we have costly crossbows. As you're walking beside the palace parade grounds, a crossbow bolt whizzes past your head and shatters against the wall behind you. Baron Vemur approaches, out of breath and waving frantically. They have a sleek, fancy-looking crossbow nestled in one hand.
Great God, Your Highness, I nearly took your head off.
Point that thing somewhere else. Sorry to scare you. I just wanted to show you this crossbow. Can shoot 3 bolts a minute and punch through Ashmedian armor at 500 yards. Beautiful, isn't she?
Trouble is, to achieve such accuracy and power, she needs to be crafted from springwood. It grows only in the forests of the coast, and those coastal bastards charge exorbitantly for it.
What does this have to do with me?
The barons of the march are guarding your borders, Your Highness, and yet we can't afford to buy the weapons we need. If you want to keep your kingdom safe, the patricians must stop price gouging. Your Serene Highness, this is outrageous. These barons just want a bargain.
All right. So, we have a variety of options. We can put a price cap on the sale of Springwood, order the patricians to send Springwood to the barons for free, refuse to limit the free market, or plant a Springwood grove in the march. And let's see here. I'm going to go ahead and use my monarch's vote. And I'm going to put a price on the cap. Or put a price cap on it. All right. It's up to you now, my wonderful nobles. You get to decide, what shall we do? Mystic Kelpie wants it for free. The barons seem to want it for free, or to simply grow it themselves. Let's see here. The patricians working together, they refuse to limit the free market. Ooh. Chiefs wanting to put a cap on the price, and also chiefs and the barons not quite working with themselves here. Patricians seem to be putting forth a unified front. However, voting is tied at 2. So now I, as the monarch, will get to choose. And I'm going to pick the one that I already liked. We're going to put a price cap on the sale of Springwood. At this price, you're practically telling us to give away our precious Springwood. There's no profit. What are we supposed to do? Starve? Obviously, the patricians don't starve, but their trade suffers. Some patricians' wealth has decreased. Meanwhile, the barons are thrilled with their shiny new crossbows. Military is now powerful. That is the end of the season. So, let's go ahead and wrap up. Alright, this one is just for me. I can tax people. So let's see here. Their goal, have the lowest defiance in 2 seasons. Well, let's go ahead and see about moving some taxes around. Where are we at? I was getting tacos. Oi. What's wrong? I need money for the treasury. No, not taxes. Look, I know we haven't always seen eye to eye, but... Alright. We'll tax the patricians a little bit. Also, one thing I forgot to mention is there is the trade bonus. The higher your trade stat, the more likely you are to get the trade bonus. The barons sell a weapons cachet to the Tatterlands, making a killing 500 wealth, and other nobles gain 200 wealth. So every member of the barons gained 500, every member of everywhere else gained 200 wealth, and I'm sorry, patricians, taxation is theft. Tax evasion is a crime, patricians. It's an obligation, monarch. All right, I'll confirm the taxes. They are now grumbling. Crab... Oh, Lord Sanic. Crab futures. Lord Patrician Sanic Hedgehog 420. The crab craze has swollen to unforeseen heights, Your Majesty. That's good, isn't it? The trade is so profitable that the patricians are shutting down textile mills to focus on crab catching. Thousands are unemployed. But who cares about that, Your Majesty? Your box of crabs is now worth nearly double what you paid for it. Hold your nerve and hold on to the crabs. Prevent the closure of factories by offering tax breaks to major industries. Or, this is a waste of everyone's time, I'll make the sale of jeweled crabs illegal. Crab time, baby. Sell, 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 baby. Penny pincher, you turned a profit on the crab market. I just got an achievement for buying and selling crabs. You sell your crabs for much more than you paid. The treasurer appears satisfied with your practicality. Meanwhile, industries collapse along the coast.
All right. The songstress is secret. Your spymaster silently appears at your desk. She has returned from a mission to investigate the songstress, and you scan her for signs that she's lost her will. You look smug.
What? I said you look smug!
She pulls a pair of plugs out of her ears. The songstress is a witch, drawing power from her lyre. It's made from magical wood, some wizard who accidentally turned himself into a tree. As many wizards are known to do. When she sings while playing the lyre, people obey, but without that, she's nothing. So, we can either send northern soldiers with earplugs to arrest her, which is an authority check with a 100% chance to pass, hire a thief to swap the magic lyre for a mundane one, have a deaf crossbowman sniper from a distance, or we can allow the songstress to keep playing. And I'm sorry, I'm not going to allow the songstress to keep playing. This ends now. And I leave it up to you, my wonderful nobles. How are we dealing with the songstress? Let's see here. We've got the chiefs rallying on A. We got a baron and a patrician voting on C, though. Ooh, the patrician split for the first time in ages. Okay. I'll give it a couple more seconds, just in case we have any last-second voters. Because we do have a couple more barons. Potentially. Yeah. Ooh, all right. And it pushes out to C. I didn't want to have to break the tie again. A week later, the songstress is performing in a market square. She opens her mouth to sing, but as she does, there's a sudden thud. A crossbow bolt is embedded in her sternum. As she folds up, the enraged audience starts tearing each other apart in a frenzy. The riots rage for weeks, but when they die down, it's as if a spell has been lifted. Damn. Okay. Kingdom stability is now teetering. The common folk forget the songstress entirely. Moving on with some new upset. It has been a bloody rain. Holy shit.
Thank you for freeing me of the witch's clutches, your greatness. For a while there, my mind was not my own.
Alright, and now, eligible options.
I have found three potential matches for you. One eligible young man from each of the kingdom's three regions. Choose wisely, you'll be securing a powerful alliance.
Yes, yes, I know, mother.
Your mother leads you to the great hall where she's arranged three portraits on easels. For now, each is covered by a cloth.
Wait, I don't even get to meet them?
There's no time for sentiment. You just need a match that befits your station and suits your political needs. She whisks away the cloth from the first portrait.
This is Laskal, firstborn son of the northern Fugo 2104 clan. From what I've heard, he knows exactly what he wants and will do whatever's necessary to get it.
Okay. Sending a pretty strapping young lad from the north.
Even among the northerners, he's made something of a name for himself as a fearsome warrior. Had a bit of controversy a while back when his clan hall burned down. Apparently his peasants were to blame.
I can see the appeal.
From the coast we have Julian, the wealthy heir to Lord Patrician Killerman 0922's estate. He's got a reputation for honesty and fair-mindedness. That's rare among the coast.
His interests are typical of the coast. Money, 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 and making more of it. There was also a scandal recently where he was publicly critical of the church. Nothing came of it.
I like the sound of him.
And finally, we have the March's offering. Rupert, scion of the prestigious Vimur bloodline. A typical baron, really. Loud and brash and self-absorbed, but mostly well-meaning. He's a zealous follower of the Ninth God, able to quote scripture backwards and forwards and at volume. Give him half a chance and he'll expound at length on how we should improve the lot of the peasants.
Sounds like a laugh.
What do you think? Of course, by picking Kennedy, you'll anger the other regions, but you'll also gain a lifelong alliance. Okay. So, I admit, I have angered the patricians a little bit. I can see their defiance is up a little, you know, which, you know, that is a problem. So we could lower that with this alliance. But also having a renowned warrior husband who knows how to keep the peasants in line sounds pretty good, seeing as we're going for authority here for Queen Morgan Morgan. We guard you? True. Alright, let's see here. Show me Laskal again. Laskal, the firstborn son of the northern Fugo 2104 clan, knows exactly what he wants and will do whatever is necessary to get it. Even among northerners, he's made something of a name for himself as a fearsome warrior, but had a bit of a controversy when his clan hall burned down. Apparently, his peasants were to blame. We got Julian, wealthy heir to the Lord Patrician Killerman estate. He's got a reputation for honest and fair-mindedness. His interests are typical of the coast. Money, money, money. There's also a scandal recently where he was publicly critical of the church. Nothing came of it. You see, I want to like Rupert. And, you know, like, the marchers have proven themselves fearsome warriors, you know, with the blood... with the blood-stained sands of the Colosseum. But, apparently, he's a zealous follower of the Ninth God, knows the scripture backwards and forwards, and the big issue is he wants to improve the lot of the peasants. And I can't go with that. I need somebody who can help me accomplish my goal of keeping these damn peasants in check. So I'm going to have to go with Laskal of the North. So congratulations, Fugo 2104 clan. Laskal shall marry Queen Morgan Morgan. End of the year. Ooh, I could get anonymous voting, swing votes. After voting, nobles can change their minds and vote a different option. Or Monarch's Golden Choice. I'll take Monarch's Golden Choice in place of my regular Monarch vote. I don't really want to place a Monarch vote. Alright, so. The Ceremony of Friendship? Question mark. Your August Majesty, too long have we let tensions simmer between us. We are citizens of the same kingdom, are we not? We worship the same god. Wasn't your son, Julian, just involved in a controversy for being critical of it? I just want to assure you that we patricians are loyal, despite the rumors. And to prove it, let's hold a ceremony of friendship where we renew our feudal vows. What a lovely idea. That crab made that. You make a good point, Sanic. You did help me invest early and sell well in the crab trade. It's basically a big party followed by a renewal of our vows of loyalty. This is a patricians only affair, by the way. Other regions are not invited. Though, unfortunately, we still need council approval to open the treasury's purse strings. Well, thanks to the patricians, we do have ample treasury at the moment. Left hundreds unemployed. It was thousands unemployed from shutting down textile mills. Alright, and I am vetoing the waste of time. So, we can either declare a day of public celebration across the kingdom, have the queen attend the private patricians-only party, and, yeah. Alright, council. It's up to you. I leave it in your capable hands. We already had the commoner swear a blood oath. So, you know, what's a little renewing of the good old feudalism vows, you know?
You need not that money? Yeah, that's fine. I've got so much. All right. It's looking like the barons have rallied together along with one of the chiefs to make it a public day. All right. Declare a day of public celebration across the kingdom. Across the kingdom, workers down their tools for the day to pay celebrate the enduring friendship of the patricians and the queen. Meanwhile, you lead the patricians on a public procession through the capital. Treasury takes a hit. Stability is now stable. As the sun sets, the patricians kneel before you in the city square and repeat their feudal vows. You anoint each of their foreheads with a dab of sacred oil. They rise to their feet again and embrace you one by one. Yeah, Jorg, it was a day where we were all celebrating. What do you mean? We'll not forget that. I have no idea what you're talking about. You are my honor guard. You have earned that, and nothing can ever take that away from you, my wonderful Baron GC. All right, Rogue Golem. Speaking of Baron GC, a rogue golem has crossed into our territory over the Ashmedian border, Your Majesty. This could be an exciting opportunity. What's a golem? A machine in the shape of a man, usually sculpted from clay or stone. The Ashmedians use them for drudge work and warfare. What's so exciting about it? Please, my liege, this is our chance to figure out how this golem magic works. We could even turn it against Ashmead. Your Majesty, the barons would drown their own grandmothers to gain an advantage over Ashmead, over the chiefs and patricians. Golems are an offense to the Ninth Guard, and they're dangerous. We should destroy it before it gets out of control. So, we can either use it as a source of labor, add it to the Marcher army, take it apart to figure out its secrets, which means we could, you know, figure out how to make more golems. Because right now we only have one golem. So we can either use the one golem for labor, add the one golem to the Marcher army, try to disassemble it to figure out how to make more golems, or we could just destroy it. And I'm going to put my Monarch's Golden Choice on figuring out its secrets. So with Monarch's Golden Choice, even if this option, option C, does not win, even if it does not win, if you choose option C, you will gain 500 personal wealth. Have at it, my wonderful court of nobles. Ooh, Glenn voting to destroy it. The chiefs are split. One wants to figure it out, and the other wants it gone. All right. Option C wins. Handily. We'll take it apart and figure out its secrets. The secret of the golems has been a mystery for too long. I'll put our very best artisans to work figuring it out. As they disassemble it, however, some kind of Ashmedian safety measure gets tripped. The golem goes wild, killing dozens of artisans. Trade challenge failed. Trade goes down to modest. Then it goes on a rampage, pulling up farmland and massacring peasants across the march. Farming is now needful. Stability is now teetering. After many casualties, Marcher troops are finally able to put it down. In the aftermath, you're left with nothing but clay shards and regret. Ouch. All right. Here we go. The royal wedding, chat. Your wedding to Laskal is, naturally, the talk of the kingdom. Nobles and peasants alike travel from across the realm to attend. For a week and a day, the capital is one giant party. It feels like you're the only one not taking part. Instead, you're getting ready for the ceremony. Soon enough, you're standing in St. Bertrand's Cathedral with Laskal at your side. Do you take this man as your lawfully wedded husband?
I do.
Then I pronounce you queen and husband.
After the wedding, of course, there's a feast. And after the feast, a dance. Your new husband, Lascal, only dances with obvious reluctance. Aw, he's a wallflower. They're just peasants. We can always get more. Jesus, patricians. By the time you find yourself alone with Lascal, it's past midnight, and you've never felt more tired.
Neither of us asked for this union.
But I assure you, it can blossom into something of mutual benefit. It's a bit of a cold approach, isn't it? Agreed? Or maybe we will fall in love once we get to know each other.
Statistically unlikely.
But
there's always a chance.
You head to your separate bedchambers. Perhaps you will draw closer in time, but for now your husband is happy to keep you at arm's length.
Oof. Didn't even get boned on wedding night.
Well, that's gonna sting. In a distant fortress. Amidst dark and foreboding forests, a small squat castle stands over the marcher border. There, at the end of the kingdom, a plot is hatching.
The kingdom's militaries are in shambles. Those pathetic weaklings couldn't fight their way through a field of rabbits.
I've drafted the reform proposals as planned. The council will be more than happy to follow our lead.
Good. We must ensure they don't get skittish. The kingdom must be stable for our purpose to work.
Grand, a calm before the storm.
For the next stage of the Baron scheme, they must raise stability to 5 or more in 2 seasons. Outwitting the Spymaster. Up in the north, Chief Glenn 149 is hosting a grand feast at his clan hall.
Our plans are going better than expected. The Spymaster thinks that all's well in the kingdom, and while the cat's away, the mice shall play. Please don't refer to us as mice. We're honorable warriors.
And also, my son is a failure who didn't do his fucking job on the way.
There's no honor in politics, my friend. Our next step is to replace the Palace Watch with our own agents. I, the Honor Guard, are incorruptible, but the Watch are another story. If the Queen can't pay them, they'll look for money elsewhere.
For the next stage of their scheme, the Chiefs must lower the Treasury to 1,500 or less in 2 seasons. If I accidentally leave, do I need to join the thingy again? I don't believe so. You are still on the noble list from her. Seeking a simulacrum. Anchored a few miles from the sunny coast, Lord Patrician Sanic Hedgehog 420 has invited his closest confidants aboard his yacht.
You said you had a surprise for me.
Indeed, and here it is. Behold.
Your Majesty, what are you doing here at such an hour? I'm sorry, I hope you didn't overhear any...
Quit babbling, you blowhard. This isn't the Queen. It's a peasant who's the Queen's spitting image.
Remarkable. And just in time. The Spymaster trusts us so much that she's not noticed that we're refitting civilian vessels into battleships.
Which means we can move on to the next phase. Kidnapping the Queen and putting this fool in her place. Wait, my dear sweet, patricians, you don't have a check mark. How are you... How do we manage that?
We need the kingdom to be in utter chaos. Bad enough that the Queen's abduction can slip past unnoticed.
For the next stage of their scheme, the patricians must lower stability to 4 or less in 4 seasons. Alright. So, the Barons of the March, you want to have stability up, and patricians of the coast, you want to have stability down. And the Chiefs are going to try to bankrupt me. Warning, the Monarch currently has no heir. I'm working on it. He's surprisingly mathematically focused for a renowned warrior.
We will not let you touch the Queen.
A horrible haunting. During a meeting with the council nobles, a commotion erupts as Lord Patrician Killerman lets out a piercing scream. By the ninth! By the ninth! It's here! It's here! He faints away, falling to the ground with a crash. By the ninth god, someone fetch water. A servant runs for water and holds it to Killerman 0922's mouth. I thought I'd be safe from it here, but lamentably, when we built that stadium on my land, some manner of specter was disturbed, and it's made me its target. What's it doing exactly? Hey, premium nobles, this is a player who has bought King of the Castle, could set their customizations, get access to special outfits, and appear more often in storylines. So we got Chief AJ the Wither.
Are we really entertaining this nonsense?
I hear voices, Your Serene Highness. Little pinpricks at the back of my mind. Just now, I saw a horrid gray shape hanging over me. Its face, a rotting mask.
We're too old for campfire tales, Killer Man.
I beg you, Your August Majesty, and gathered nobles, come to my aid. We must banish this wraith. So, how should the haunted stadium be dealt with? We can either send an inquisitor to exorcise the site, research the land on which the stadium is built, or ignore the situation. All will be fine. And I'll let you all have at it. Go crazy, chat. Let's see how this goes. Got the barons splitting up, patricians splitting up. The chiefs seem to be voting as one for the time being. All right, I'll give it a couple more seconds just in case we have any last second voters. Damn it, can't change votes? Correct. I do not have swing vote as one of my laws. If I had swing vote, you could change your vote. Alright, let's simply do some research. I don't want to spend too much money exorcising a ghost. It sounds expensive. You summon the chief architect, who nods thoughtfully when you explain the situation. This sort of thing's an occupational hazard when building on historical sites. Keep on your toes. Keeps you on your toes, doesn't it? It's your job to make sure the buildings are ghost-free. Of course, Your Majesty. I'm sure it'll be easy enough to sort out. He hurries off to Quail University to delve through the records. You can only hope Killerman 0922's troubles do not get worse in the meantime.
The only use for the church, and we didn't use it. Church does not turn down the Lord's work.
Oh, the crab bubble bursts. Uh-oh. Lord Sanic Hedgehog 420.
Bad news, Your Majesty. A new reef has been discovered, which is overflowing with millions of jeweled crabs. Crab prices are crashing catastrophically.
What?
The entire kingdom will suffer financially, Your Majesty, with the exception of a few patricians. Curiously, Lord Patrician Sanic Hedgehog 420, the very same patrician who began the crab craze, recently sold all his crabs at a huge profit just days before the crash. Interesting how that works. So some chief's wealth has decreased, some patrician's wealth has decreased, some baron's wealth has decreased, but Lord Patrician Sanic the Hedgehog 420's wealth has increased from 350 to 1850. Hey man, it's just good time.
Something must be done. You summon your council to discuss the crab price crisis. Many assembled nobles have invested heavily in the crab market, and they are casting furious glances at the patrician's benches. So we can either bail out the failed businesses along the coast, let the coast suffer the full consequences of this crisis, or arrest Lord Patrician Sanic Hedgehog 420 and confiscate his ill-gotten gold. I'm going to go ahead and veto bailing out the coast. I'm sorry, Coast. Just because I played it well doesn't mean I'm going to let you get away with it playing it too well. So, my dear nobles, I let this matter rest in your hands.
Ooh. The marchers are looking for an arrest, but so far the chiefs and patricians are looking to let the coast suffer. Ooh, it's close. Ooh, all right. Voting is closed. Let the coast suffer the full consequences of this crisis. There are reports of queues of bankrupt merchants waiting to jump from the tallest towers on the coast. Exaggeration. There is lines on the tops of the tallest buildings of businessmen waiting to jump off. Holy shit. What you've done. All right, rising tempers.
Morgan, I have something I need to discuss with you. Baron Vermeer challenged my honor, calling me a coward only fit to fight training dummies. I must duel them at once. What little reputation I have depends on it.
I can either... You're not fighting anyone, which lowers my authority. Give them a good kicking for me.
By the old gods, I will. Not to worry.
The next day, Baron Vermeer is summoned to the fighting ring for the much-anticipated duel.
You've always been a coward, Lascal. Don't worry. There's still time to back down.
Let's see here.
Ooh, it's even chances. It is a coin flip.
I'll cheer for Lascal.
Lascal grins ever so slightly. The two combatants circle each other like lions, their axes drawn and pointed at each other.
When they finally come to blows, the fight is over almost as quickly as it begins. A quick parry here, a thrust there, and suddenly Baron Vermeer is holding up their hands in a display of surrender.
Let's go! Well fought, you win.
Lascal does not look much happier, but at least he's proven his valor and vindicated the family name.
That's my boy! That's my husband right there! That's my Lascal!
He does the Fugo clan proud. Alright. And it is time for an auction again. So, we've got a variety of things that you can vote for. And for the uninitiated, because I know we've had a few new people show up, you can vote for any building you want. It does not have to be within your faction, but... There are some things that affect kingdom stats, such as stability, like the library and the prison. Those affect the kingdom stats. Anything that's like trade or military affects the region that it is being built in. So, for example, if the barons built a cathedral, the barons would gain faith, but no other region would gain faith. So, let's go ahead and get this underway. Exclamation point fund, and then XY, where X is the letter of the building you want to fund, and Y is how much you want to give it. Letter, then amount. Let's see here. We got a library coming up for the barons. Oh, holy shit. Lord Sanic the Hedgehog 420 dumping all of his money straight into the prison. All of the money he made from those jeweled crabs straight to building prisons in the coast. They want to keep that stability down. Goddamn. All right. Looks like the barons are starting to come together to get some money up. So the library is still in second. Now there is some funding for the monument. And also funding for the fortress coming out as well. It is not guaranteed. Ooh, but that's the clock. Time is up. The buildings funded are the prison, with the biggest contributor, Lord Patrician Sanic Hedgehog 420, and then the library with its biggest contributor, Baron Vermeer. So we have minus stability, plus stability. Alright. Chief Architect returns.
Your Majesty, I discovered something interesting about the land on which Lord Patrician Kellerman 0922's haunted stadium was built.
Good, tell me.
The ghost is actually Killerman 0922's great-great-uncle Emiliano. He isn't haunting the building, he's haunting him.
My great uncle is angry with me? I never even knew him. I can call upon Quail University for more information. By the ninth, I don't need information. I just want this ghost gone. So, how shall we attempt to remove the ghost altogether? We can either continue researching great-great-uncle Emiliano, ask Killerman 0922 to find out what the ghost wants, which will lower faith, or we can have Killerman exorcised. And you know what? That sounds kind of funny to me, so I'll put a Monarch's Golden Choice on it. Go ham, nobles. Remember, if you vote for the Monarch's Golden Choice, you'll gain 500 to your personal wealth. Killer Man wants to ask the ghost, but it seems everyone else is voting to have him exercised. Even his fellow patrician is in it for the money. Voting is closed. I need money. Maybe if you didn't spend all your money on a prison. The High Inquisitor hauls Killerman 0922 into a special quarantine room. She reports back swiftly. The ghost hanging around Killerman 0922 may have been a demon maddening him, Your Majesty. Certainly, it was stronger than we expected. Faith challenge succeeded. 30% chance on that faith. Faith challenge succeeded. But my inquisitors can handle anything. They stayed awake for 3 days, performing a ritual with holy water and candles. Killerman 0922 is safe. The church prevails. Yep, faith is now steadfast in the coast. And Killerman 0922's family sends a very nice gift to say thank you for the help. He's sleeping much better these days. Treasury has gone up. Okay. Chiefs are on the struggle bus here. They are trying to bankrupt me, but I've got so much treasury at the moment. About my heir. Your marriage to Lascal has grown stale. Oh, you get along well enough. You've made some good memories together, but there's no spark. He cares more about perfecting his combat moves than your happiness. But spark or no spark, you still need an heir. Congratulations are in order. The royal wedding was a magnificent affair. Felt more like a life sentence than a wedding. Oh, don't be so dramatic. You've done well so far, but something's still missing. An heir. You need someone young whose loyalty is assured. A child of your own would do the trick, even if they're a bastard or the youngest of your many cousins. So I can either be like, yeah, my husband and I will have a child. Pretty sure I have a bastard child lying around somewhere. I'm sorry, Morgan, you've been... Morgan, you are already a mother? You've got a bastard lying around somewhere? I'll make my youngest cousin my heir, or plan to adopt a lowborn child from the orphanage. No, we can make one ourselves. On the traditional method, no one will object to that. I'll arrange for you to take a month off ruling so you can get down to business. I'm taking a month off to get fucking... Okay. Well, yeah, honestly, even without, like, finishing that statement, it just, that works to get fucking. Your Majesty, I've received worrying reports. Worrying and confusing. I'm constantly worried and confused. Yes, Your Majesty, I did get that impression. I've received reports from one of my little birdies in Lord Patrician Sonic Hedgehog 420's villa. He has a most unusual guess. Let me guess, the second god himself? No. It's you, Your Majesty, or someone who looks just like you. I have no reason to suspect the patricians are plotting anything yet. I can't square this away. Unfortunately, I can't devote too many resources to solving this puzzle with the kingdom in such a lamentable state. Too busy fighting fires elsewhere. I recommend you call a council meeting and try to do something to put a stop to this. Very well. Assemble them at once. So we can either triple security around the palace, conduct a thorough search of the coastal villas, which will delay the scheme for a season, or we can do nothing. And I'm going to veto doing nothing. We are going to do something, my nobles. What we do, I leave up to you. We can either triple security, or we can conduct a thorough search of the coastal villas, which delays it for only a season. So we can either buy ourselves one season of leeway, or we can intentionally raise our stability, because they wanted to lower stability. Chiefs are voting A because they want to lower my treasury, and the barons are voting A because they want to raise stability. Fair enough. I should have seen that coming. Voting is closed. All right, we're tripling security around the palace. Ranks of your palace watch are swollen with new men, and a strict curfew is set up within a 2-mile radius of the palace. Should help keep you safe, but the nobles think it's a display of weakness. There are rumors that you are slipping into paranoia. Stop them, greens. All right, in the season, military reforms. After several rounds of deliberations, the council approves wide-ranging reforms to the kingdom's standing armies. The barons are the major contributor to this new model army, having volunteered their expertise and manpower in these trying times. Meanwhile, in a foreboding marcher fortress, the barons are celebrating.
I can hardly believe they went for it.
This is all well and good, but we have not won yet. We must make our final preparations before we take control. So, barons, this is just for you. You can either try to march on the capital with the full strength of the new model army, which your goal is to raise your military, or quietly force the queen to abdicate. Your goal is to lower authority. So you can either try to raise your military and just outright coup me, or try to convince me to just go ahead and let it go. It's up to you, barons. Ooh. All right, it's a split vote, and it's no longer split. There we go. Barons have voted. They will march on the capital with the full strength of the new model army.
Then it's settled. We have a plan of attack, but one last thing remains: defense. For our final march on the capital, we'll need a sizable home garrison to repel opportunistic attacks from the other regions.
For the final stage of their scheme, the barons must raise their military to at least 8. Blackmail and bribery. Up in the north, Chief Glenn 149 has gathered his fellow plotters for a hike through the mountains.
The palace watch won't accept our bribes. The treasury's practically overflowing. They don't need our money.
And I suppose they ran straight to the spymaster to blab about it, too. Damn our luck. Is this the end?
Did Voltor give up after his first defeat at the hands of the Eater of the Sun? We will bide our time and strike again when the queen least expects it.
The chief's aim is to lower the treasury to 1,500 or less. Planning an abduction. Somewhere along the coast, Lord Patrician Sanic Hedgehog 420 strolls in his olive grove, accompanied by a close friend.
The kingdom's not exactly peaceful, but there's still no way we could stage an abduction of the queen without being noticed. We need chaos.
The Patrician's aim is to lower stability to 4 or less. And text time. I like money.
Money, baby.
Let's go. Now I can just pay off all my problems. Yeah, that's right. I'm keeping you all in check. I'm keeping that all that obscene personal wealth down. Our money. My money taxes. Fuck. Maybe the patricians had a point all those seasons ago. My pockets have been ran. Fuck your taxes.
Oh, it's good to be the queen.
This will not go unnoticed.
Oh, boy.
Well, we've got 3 events this season, and they are all in the march. Noble kidnapped.
Your Majesty, the loyal and noble Baron Mystic Kelpie has been taken hostage.
What would the kidnappers want with him?
It's some criminal organization. These horrid miscreants demand gold and safe passage to Ashmead in exchange for Mystic Kelpie's return.
So, we can either pay the ransom for Baron Mystic Kelpie's release, send the march's troops after the kidnappers, or ignore the letter. And, you see, I want to see how good this new model army of yours actually is, barons. So, If we send the March's troops, 500 personal wealth. I know people are a little light in the pockets at the moment, so I think they would appreciate having this here. Let's see this new model army of yours in action. 7 seconds left. Let's see here. We've got one to ignore the letter. The patricians are split. And the barons are unanimous in testing out their new army. All right. The outlaws are no match for the March's forces, which rush to Mystic Kelpie's aid. During their raid, Marcher fighters even recover a hoard of gold and gems shared between the treasury and the barons. My dear sweet barons. Oh, fair enough. Mystic Kelpie's rich after surviving being kidnapped. We got you. I appreciate you. Treasury went from 4,600 to 6,082. What the hell? I might just start blowing gold, you know, just send it away. Solve my problems. Call for apprentices, Baron Mystic Kelpie. Hey, Mr. Kelpie, glad you made it back to the march.
Bad news, Your Highness. A meddling wizard has set up shop in Hardsburg. I believe it is Pestia, Lady of Pestia, of Pestilence.
Tell me more about this wizard.
Wizards have managed to tame creation itself. They wield untold power and are naturally distrusted by the church. Even the High Inquisitor wouldn't dare move against them openly. Pestia has influence over plagues, diseases, insects, and other horrid things like that. She's put out a call for new apprentices, which is a rare event. This is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for many. Droves of unwashed, glory-seeking common folk from all over the march are lining up for their chance. Not just peasants. I, AJ the Wither, have also decided to apply. The competition will be fierce, but those villagers are no match. I will be the most powerful noble this council has ever seen. You couldn't put your clothes on if it wasn't for your servant's help. We can't let this go ahead. Not only is it heresy, it presents a clear and dangerous conflict of interest.
Conflict of interest? How?
Wizards answer only to themselves. Their power is unmatched, such that entire kingdoms cannot stand against them. Even an apprentice on the council would be disastrous. Chief AJ the Wither could use magic to interfere with votes, or you, for that matter.
Then we shall assemble the council.
Thanks, Your Majesty.
All right, so we can either allow Chief AJ the Wither to become Pestia's apprentice, require he forfeits his noble title in order to become an apprentice, or forbid AJ the Wither from traveling to Hartsburg. So, I am going to go use the restroom. I leave this in your hands, my nobles.
I shall see what you have chosen upon my return.
chat. I have returned, and let's see what you've come up with.
Require he forfeits his noble title in order to become an apprentice. All right. 5 nobles voted for it.
I suppose this is an acceptable compromise.
AJ the Wither begins his journey to Hartsburg immediately. Chief AJ the Wither's wealth has been decreased, and the treasury has now gone up to 6,730. I am comically rich. His successor, Chief AJ the Wither II, inherits his position on the council, but the treasury confiscates the vast majority of his wealth as payment. Chief AJ the Wither has died. AJ the Wither II has joined the council. Pestia's presence in Hartsburg attracts all sorts of visitors, though the power of her latent magic starts to wilt crops for miles around. Farming is now meager. Trade is now dynamic. Oh, what's that? I taxed everyone last season? A taxing issue. Your Majesty, help us! Baron Vermeer of the March has been bleeding us dry, they have. Not literally, I hope. No, I'm making use of a common idiom, Your Majesty. Our taxes are 10 times higher than they've ever been. I can't afford to feed my cows. It's true, Your Majesty. Baron Vermeer has been taxing their peasants at least twice as much as the next highest noble. It's been a hard year, Your Highness. I have barely any gold in my vault. I'm just doing what I can to stay afloat. So, what about this poor peasant's cows as a matter for the council's consideration? Or... This is a matter for the council's consideration, I think. It's almost harvesting season. So we can either throw Baron Vermeer into the dungeon to teach them a lesson, allow Baron Vermeer to keep overtaxing their peasants, or have a royal tax collector take over tax duties in the march. Go ham, chat. Wow, the barons have really split themselves. They put a different person on each option. Saying this wouldn't have to happen if Rose didn't tax so hard, no such thing as overtaxing. Alright, but you see, chat, I had reverse voting on. I turned that on before I started the vote. It's been a little notification right there next to the seconds remaining. So you were supposed to vote for the option that you didn't want to see happen, so we have a tie between B and C. So Baron Vermeer was spared the dungeons. But I'm going to have a royal tax collector take over duties in the march, thank you. Oh, the sweet, sweet treasury, baby. I am a fool. Oh, I thought you figured it out, Yorg. I thought you voted A intentionally to help your fellow baron. But no, you were actually trying to put your fellow baron in jail. By the ninth, tax collection has been our duty since the days of old. Why should the rest of us be punished for Baron Vermeer's mistakes? Ooh, Baron GC does not like that. Royal tax collector proves to be diligent and efficient, but the barons are outraged at the implication that they can't be trusted. Some barons' wealth has decreased, but the treasury is fat. Oh my god. I have a massive, throbbing treasury. What the hell? That's the highest I've ever seen. Ooh, I could get stop the count. That could be funny. So with stop the count, the timer would be halved. Normally you get 30 seconds, but I can extend it by choosing to not end the vote. With stop the count, you get half the time. And it auto ends. Alright, here we go.
It looks like we've got three events over in the north this time, as opposed to down there. Ah, Chief Glenn 149.
Your Majesty, this year we will be holding the Winter Feast in my clan hall. It would be an honor if you could attend.
Winter Feast? What's that?
10 days of drinking, eating, fighting, competing, drinking, singing, stamping, drinking, and drinking, Your Majesty. All will take place in the coldest time of the year, as the snows bury us in. But you won't need to wrap up warm. That's what the whiskey is for.
I look forward to it.
Ha! I can't wait! Winter Feast is a special time of year.
You'll see. I'm bringing my husband with me. Because I still don't have a goddamn heir. I'll take him drinking if I have to. I need something to put him in the mood. Blood money. Chief AJ the Wither II. What are you talking about?
Nothing is wrong. Absolutely nothing is wrong in the north.
This calls for a celebratory glass of wine, I think.
That's definitely not an old witch who lives at the border of my lands, and I definitely haven't been having money problems.
Okay, so maybe my overtaxing of all of my vassals has driven them to some desperate stuff.
And most importantly, she didn't offer me a fortune in exchange for just a drop of my blood, an offer which I absolutely didn't accept.
Keep looking at me like I've trod on your foot. Great stuff, where's my wine?
Ever since I didn't accept the witch's bargain, I haven't found myself obeying her every command. I definitely still rule over my estate, not her. Furthermore, she didn't forbid me from telling you any of this, and I'm not using negative statements to bypass her magic.
Hang on, I'm starting to think you mean the opposite of what you say.
Nay, your greatness, that's not the case.
It isn't, damn, I guess I was wrong. No, let's fetch the court physician to see if we can lift your curse. After a week confined to a cold iron box with nothing to eat but salt, the magic stops affecting Chief AJ the Wither II so strongly. He's even been able to talk about his ordeal directly.
I always tolerated that bloody witch. She'd sell medicine to the peasants and help them find lost sheep. I never suspected she was capable of something like this. We need to call a vote. Send a regiment to take back my stolen lands.
Let's see here. So we're going to have to take back AJ the Withers, the second the lands, and burn the witch at the stake. Take back the land, but let the witch go free. Or let AJ the Wither the second suffer the full consequences of his bargain, which I will spare him from. It's up to you, my nobles. Nope, can't vote C, Kelpie. I'm sorry, I vetoed it. Can't just let him suffer the consequences of his actions. Let's see here, we got the chiefs voting A. All the barons unanimously agree to go for B. Interesting. Give it a little more time, just in case. In case we have any last-second voters. All right. Voting is closed. Take back AJ the Wither of the Second's land, but let the witch go free. When the northern troops arrive at AJ the Wither the Second's estate, they find that the witch has already fled, along with what remained of AJ the Wither the Second's gold. Peasants have no memory of their time under the witch's rule, but the churches have been burned, with profane messages scrawled on their charred walls. Faith can't go lower. Fields are never again as bountiful as they were under the witch's reign. Farming is now meager. And a spot of heresy. Chifuo 2104.
Your Majesty, I'm stunned, outraged, and incensed. I've been summoned to trial by the Inquisition on some nonsense fabricated charge.
They're saying a group of church missionaries went missing near my lands. The weather's cold around there. Anything could have happened to them. No one dares defend me on their own. They're too scared of the High Inquisitor. The trial is set, but the council must intervene, your greatness.
Though she remains silent, the council is keenly aware of the High Inquisitor's steely gaze from across the chamber. So we can either search for a witness to defend Chief Fugo, help the Inquisitor gather evidence against Fugo, or suggest he pray for a good outcome. I'm going to set stop the count. We'll see how it goes. 10 seconds, chat. Quick, quick, quick. No time for thinking. What are we doing for the boy? All right. Search for a witness to defend Chief Fugo 2104. You distribute a proclamation among the chiefs asking for a witness of Fugo 2104's innocence. But from fear of church reprisal or distrust of the crown, no one comes forward. Stability drops by 2. Which now sets up patricians. Oh boy. Patricians are still in the game. During the trial, Fugo 2104 crumbles and can barely argue for his own innocence. Unsmiling, the High Inquisitor orders him to be taken away and thrown in the Inquisition's special dungeons. Chief Fugo 2104 has been imprisoned. Fugo 2104 II has joined the council. Vascal, you never told me you had a brother. Alright. Planning an abduction. The kingdom's on the brink of chaos. It's perfect. We have to strike. What do you intend us to do? Swoop in and kidnap the queen in full view of the honor guard and the palace watch? No, of course not. We need to use the chaos to our advantage. We have 2 options. Alright, so the goal is either to lure the queen to the coast and abduct her there, raise your own defiance, or manufacture a food crisis and kidnap the queen during the relief efforts, lower own farming. What's it gonna be, my patricians? This is up to you. What will be the final stage of your scheme? Let's see here. Killer Man votes to lure the queen to the coast and abduct her there. Goal, raise own defiance. And they're unanimous. Damn it. You guys are going to force me to bribe the patricians, which will give them personal wealth and lower my treasury, which sets up for the chiefs. Putting me in a tight spot here. Okay. We need to convince the queen that the coast is on the verge of rebellion. In the current climate, she'll be forced to take a diplomatic visit to smooth things over. That's when we strike. One queen enters the peace tent, the other queen leaves. Serves you right. Hey, they're... If they replace me, it's a problem for you too, Kelpie. You might be in the endgame of your stage, or your scheme, but they're in their endgame now too. The only one that's been sort of safely quarantined for the time being is the chiefs, but I'm about to have to start letting that slip to keep the rest of you at bay. Oh, please, your heir. Your quest for an heir is finally complete. Thank you, Lascal. Let's go. You stand before the council holding a small child in your arms. Should I die, I ask that my crown be passed down to... Council hall is filled with nervous silence. My son. The assembled nobles break out into polite applause. By the designating of an heir, you've cemented the stability of the kingdom. Rose, as long as you let me tax the poor, I have no problem with abusing the peasantry. You go ham. Speaking of which, my liege, may I be the first to congratulate you on the birth of your son. What is his name? Morgan II. Huzzah, Your Highness. I'm sure little Morgan II will grow up to be a chip off the old block. Congratulations on finding an heir. Now you just need to fulfill your ambition to win the game. Expect a visit from the Spymaster soon. Okay. I have an heir. So I have completed one of my goals now. Uh-oh.
wizardry meddling.
Ox of my ancestors, how many times do I have to tell you he's not my responsibility anymore?
It was your father who stole all my gold. Someone must pay. Baron Mystic Kelpie. So AJ the Wither the First didn't actually die, but successfully became the wizard's apprentice and stole Baron Mystic Kelpie's gold. Let's go!
Have mercy, your greatness. The former chief, AJ the Wither, turned up at my estate demanding my jewelry and valuables, saying they were needed in Hartsburg for research. He kept babbling about strong electromagnetic fields or some such nonsense. I warned you, wizards always cause trouble.
So we can either force Chief AJ the Wither II to pay for his father's debt. His wealth is too low. He has no money. Because if you recall, he got his money from a deal he made with a witch, but then we let the witch go and she ran off with his money. So we literally can't. So we can either summon the wizard to answer for her apprentice's crimes, the barons will have to do something about their pretty... we'll have to do without their pretty necklaces, or we can compensate Mystic Kelpie from the treasury. I'm going to put my monarch's golden choice on summoning the wizard. I leave it all to you, my nobles. Ooh. Patricians voting D? Want to just make the barons have to eat it? Ooh, no. Never mind. The patricians are split. The chiefs are rallying together to try and lower the treasury. Makes sense for them. But the barons stand together to force the wizard to answer for her apprentice's crimes. All right. Voting is closed. You send out the summons, but receive no answer. Either Pestia thinks you are not a threat, or that you are simply not worth her time. In the meantime, more barons are soon deprived of their valuables. Chickens, cigars, family heirlooms, and a few prized hogs, all in the name of progress. Or so AJ the Wither claims. My authority has been decreased to 7. Some barons' wealth has decreased, and Defiance is now grumbling. All right. And finally, the Stone Maiden. Baron Vermeer, behold, your majesty. Baron Vermeer pulls aside a tarpaulin to reveal a granite statue of Baron Mystic Kelpie. The statue is impeccably detailed, its expression a frozen grimace. A sad sight, is it not? Sculptor must be most talented.
No, your highness. This is no statue. It seems the Stone Maiden is abroad in the market.
No! Mystic Kelpie got kidnapped by bandits, freed from the bandits, got his lost a bunch of money to the Jeweled Crab fiasco, financially recovered, got robbed by a wizard, and now has been Medusa'd. Isn't there a fairy tale about the Stone Maiden?
Old women scare their children with tales of her, aye. She's a walking statue with burning yellow eyes. All who meet her gaze are turned to stone. She sleeps for years at a time before waking and terrorizing the kingdom. She must have ambushed Baron Mystic Kelpie on his latest hunting trip. Please, your highness, we must do something.
Baron Mystic Kelpie has died. Mystic Kelpie II joins the council. Damn, you had a rocky path to get there. So we can either hire a wizard to take care of this, send an army to smash this thing to rubble, tell everyone in the march to hide, or consult the fairy tales for a solution. I leave it to you, my nobles. How shall we do this? Ten seconds left. Looks like chiefs and one of the
barons want to hire a wizard, we can hire Pestia. All right. Voting is closed. Hire a wizard to take care of this. You send out word that you need a wizard, and fast. A few days later, one arrives and presents a hideous spectacle indeed. The wizard is a smoking ruin of twisted slag, mouth stretched into a silent scream, carried into your throne room atop a palanquin. He is set down carefully by a team of sickly-looking apprentices.
Gordius, I hear you are having trouble with a woman who turns people to stone. A matter I regretfully have some experience with. I can make this problem go away for the advertised fee and a small sacrifice. All I require is one of the queen's teeth.
For what possible reason?
That's wizard business.
Survey the worried faces of your nobles. Allowing this wizard to pull out a royal tooth looks weak, but condemning your citizens looks cowardly. I refuse. Get out of here. Exquisite voice acting, Sire. Thank you.
Very well. But remember that you could have avoided what comes next.
The Stone Maiden, enraged, stalks the march for weeks on end, turning thousands of peasants into twisted granite figurines. At long last, she retreats to her lair deep underground and falls asleep once more. On the bright side, the barons now have plenty of oddly realistic statues to sell. What happened to harvest? It's almost harvesting season. They're getting turned to stone. It's almost harvesting season. Gone. Alright, so, we do have an auction coming up. So, remember, you want to do exclamation point fund XY, where X is the letter, then number. So, fund, letter, and amount. Start the auction. Alright. It's on you, chat. What shall the nobles vote for this time? Yorg dumping all of his money straight into the fortress. Baron GCS wanted to give a bunch. Let's see here. We got funding for the aqueduct as well. You would need to have two buildings gain money to push out the fortress. So if you could get like the monument and the aqueduct, you could push the fortress out. So the barons are making damn sure. Holy crap. Mystic Kelpie funding the fortress for 1,500 additional. They, those barons, absolutely want this military bonus. All right, time's up. We want that. Buildings have been funded. Biggest contributor, GCS. Baron GCS. Mount funded. Aqueduct for farming by Lord Patrician Killerman 0922. All right. Your ambition. At the start of your reign, you said you wanted to be remembered as the greatest queen who ever lived. You're well on the track to achieve that aim. Well done, Your Majesty. Hey, defiance down across the board. But to shut down your noble scheming for good, we need to build on that reputation. Your advisors have some ideas.
We should crush those disloyal nobles, smash their armies, and force them to submit. On the other hand, Your Majesty, if you helped us spread the zeal of the Ninth Guard, the Church will lend our full support. With the backing of the Church, the nobles wouldn't dare move against you.
So,
We can do authority and military, or authority and faith. So I could win on military, potentially, before... I love military? Yeah, so do I. And I might be able to win on it before you do. Because I'm tracking everyone's military. So I just have to keep Baron military at 7, because the Patricians only have a military of 3. So if we can boost Patrician military, that could work. Otherwise, I have to try and force faith onto the chiefs. I either have to get military on the patricians or faith on the chiefs. I'm going to go with faith.
A wise decision, your majesty. I'll send word to my priests. But of course, you need to be worthy. Your priority is to raise your authority and the kingdom's overall faith as much as you can. And of course, there can't be open rebellion among the nobles.
Alright. And there's food riots down in the march. Baron GCS.
Your Majesty, the famine in the march grows worse by the day. The riots are breaking out in all the major townships, from Kellenberg to Zermimar. Starving mobs are pillaging bakeries, granaries, and merchant houses. What are we to do?
You have a farming of 0. Oh my goodness, barons. Yeah, they're sending an army to control the riots, import mass amounts of food to Tavalon and Kurth. The barons buy up surplus grain from the patricians, or order grain supplies to be diverted from the coast. Well, I am going to... Let's see here. I'm going to put a Monarch's Golden Choice on the riots. Let's send in the army to help control these riots a little bit. That's my thought process anyway. We got a whole split of votes at the moment. Let's see how some of these other votes come in. We got 5 seconds. I'll give a couple more seconds, see if the chiefs want to have any input, maybe. Care not now. All right. I got me my voting tied at 2. So the baron should buy up surplus grain from the patricians or send in the army. Let's send in the army. Grim-faced marcher soldiers break up the riots in brutal fashion, driving the starving peasants away and leaving dozens dead. Barricades are set up on major thoroughfares. Martial law has, effectively, been declared. This does help to restore some order to the march, but it does nothing to alleviate the famine, which worsens by the day. Peasants are resorting to eating grass and stripping bark off the trees. Jeez, that's brutal. Panic in the council.
Your esteemed highness, I bring bad news from the coast. We are receiving reports of...
I'm sure your news can wait. I bring urgent tidings from the north that demand the queen's attention at once. Wait your turn, you ignorant dolt!
Why don't you settle this quarrel outside? Meanwhile, I suggest news from the march that really is urgent.
Now, one at a time.
The industries of the coast are in grave danger. The workers are striking. They demand fewer hours and higher pay.
Is that all? By the old gods, the north is increasingly lawless, your highness. Some chiefs have taken advantage, declaring themselves independent of your rule.
My news is worse still. Order in the march has broken down, your highness. Some battalions have killed their own officers and begun roving the wilderness, acting like common bandits. All of these problems have arisen because the kingdom is increasingly unstable, your majesty. Something must be done.
What do you suggest?
Unfortunately, we lack the resources to tackle all these problems at once. We must vote on which matter to prioritize.
So, we can either send troops to bring the independent chiefs back into the kingdom, break up the strikes along the coast, or hunt down the outlaws
deserting in the march. Well, respectfully, and hear me out here, chiefs. There is not much I can do here for you at the moment in terms of lowering my treasury. But if you are willing, I am more than happy to help line your pockets next tax season. My chiefs, and this also extends to my patricians, if you vote for C, my patricians, my chiefs, if you vote for C when the time comes, I will give you a beautiful, beautiful tax break. I will line your pockets with more gold than you can imagine. All we have to do is vote C. All right, votes are coming in. 15 seconds now. Chiefs, patricians, I will pay you handsomely, beyond your wildest dreams, if you can vote C in this time of need. Ooh, even a baron, Mystic Kelpie. Hunt down outlaws and deserters in the march. Voting has closed. Hunt down the outlaws and deserters in the march. Thanks to a helpful snitch, your marshal discovers the location of all the outlaws' hideouts in the march. Over the next month, the deserters are subjected to swift public trials, followed by even swifter public executions. The army is depleted, but much more disciplined. The crisis in the march has been quashed, making the kingdom as a whole slightly more stable, but the nobles of other regions feel you are ignoring their problems. All right, that is that season. And my sweet, sweet patricians and my sweet, sweet chiefs, never let it be said that your queen does not pay her dues. Now then, as for you, barons, one of you did vote with me. Mystic Kelpie did vote in favor of what I asked for. And for that favor, even though I did not extend the offer to the barons, because a baron, I believed, would not be capable of coming to see my reasons, because a baron was willing to side with me regardless, I believe we can come to know a bit of peace. All right. Ambition, sainthood.
Your Majesty, I've received messages from the priests beyond the capital. They've been working hard to promote your power in every sermon.
Ah, I love to see the church and state working together.
Absolutely, Your Majesty.
Listen to the priest's letters. 70% chance authority roll.
Unfortunately, we've hit some difficulties. Damn. The nobles challenge your claims of holding a special place in the Ninth's favor. The common folk are similarly unconvinced.
Damn, I didn't win the game. So the game is still afoot, Yorg.
I just paid you guys, and I didn't win off of it.
So, Kelpie almost did you a favor. Well, he didn't. He did screw you, but it's worked out, I guess.
To improve your chances of victory, focus on increasing the kingdom's authority and faith as much as possible in the next 2 seasons. The challenge will decrease in difficulty with each failed attempt.
Alright, so if the game stalls for too long, it gets easier for me to win. You will have your head. Someone's giving me head. Hey, yep. What's that, York? You're lower than the best.
After weeks of leading your baggage train along perilous mountain roads, you finally arrive at the snow-swept clan hall of Chief Glenn 149. The hall is crammed with all the chiefs of the north, sitting cheek to cheek, which cheeks? Along tables, groaning under the weight of food and ale.
Welcome, Your Majesty, to my humble hall. Take a seat, grab a drink. It is customary at Winterfeast to exchange gifts with the host. What did you bring?
A casket overflowing with sapphires.
This is far beyond what was necessary. Your Majesty, I will be forever in your debt. Now I can afford to repair those blasted roads.
I got money to burn. Let's go. After that, the feast lasts long into the night. The fires roar, the bards sing songs of the old days, and a lake of ale is consumed. A couple hours in, you are extremely, extremely drunk. The chiefs appreciate how much you're getting into the spirit of things. They roar with laughter at your mumbled jokes. Someone claps you on the shoulder so hard your crown falls into your beer. As Winterfeast draws on and the snow piles up outside the doors, the mood in the hall turns raucous. Your memory is blotchy, but you distinctly recall leading the entire hall in a song. The chiefs roar alongside you, full-throated, as you sing the stirring battle songs of the north, long into the night. When you wake the next morning, you find yourself sprawled out in the hall. Glenn 149 is sitting beside you, eating some bacon and eggs.
You really got into the swing of things last night, Your Majesty. Mighty impressed I was. Didn't even think you knew the words of some of those songs. To be honest, Your Majesty, you may have gotten too into the swing of things.
Break it to me gently.
You sang some songs that are very aggressive towards the other regions. The kinds of songs that rhyme with pillage and village.
Word quickly spreads. Accusations of northern favoritism become a thorn in your side. Ah, damn it. Look, I know I married Lascal, and, you know, we have an heir together, and I went to Winterfeast, and I bribed the chiefs. Okay, I can see what I bribed all of you. Admittedly, it wasn't just the chiefs. I bid farewell to the chiefs and began the long, perilous journey back to the capital. Keep them lips tight from now on. Apparently, I need to. And an invitation. Your Majesty, you absolutely must come down to the coast next year and experience the Summer Games for yourself. It's the only social event that matters. If you aren't in attendance, well, it would simply be a crime. How could I say no? Oh, this is simply wonderful. It's been so long since a queen attended the games. Last time, as I recall, they were assassinated. Not to worry, Your Majesty. I'll make sure it doesn't happen to you. All right, that's the end of the season. So, yes, please, Monarch's Iron Choice. Let's play Stop the Count. All right. Let's see here. A brand new harvester. Baron Vermeer. Your Highness, the scholars and great thinkers of the coast have invented a new farming implement. Some kind of horse-drawn machine that automatically reaps and threshes grain. They call it a wheat eater, and it's revolutionizing agriculture. It would be of great use to us in the march. Our farms are struggling to keep up with demand, you know. We'll not share our designs with the likes of you, Marcha Leech. Our people worked hard on that machine. We deserve to reap its rewards, not you. So we can either force the patricians to distribute their designs, compensate the patricians for the invention and share it with other regions, leave the machines in the coast only, or halt the production of these machines. They're an affront to honest farmers everywhere. So, marchers, I know you are desperate for farming. I know your people are starving. Your peasants are literally eating grass. However, if you force the patricians to distribute their designs, their defiance goes up, and that could put them potentially to completing their scheme. So, marchers, we cannot vote A. Chiefs, I know I have little I can interest you with, but I believe we can all come to an agreement. I lower the treasury for the chiefs, and everyone else can gain some wealth. Ooh, Yorg's really... Let's see here. Alright, the barons seem to be wanting to raise defiance in the coast. They might be handing the patricians a victory, depending on how this goes. If this raises their defiance by 2, it could be a patrician victory. I tried negotiating, you know? Never let it be said that I didn't try. But, force the patricians. There it is. It raised by 2. That might be GG. That might be GG. It's tyranny, I tell you. You're punishing innovation and shackling the free market. It won't like that. In fact, the market doesn't mind much. The machines go a long way to improving agriculture in other regions, making your kingdom more prosperous as a whole. Better them than you, Rose? I literally just failed my check. You still have a chance. We have food. All right. Putting on a show. Lord Patrician, Sanic Hedgehog 420. Your Serene Highness, I have most wonderful solution to all that excess gold cluttering your treasury. We should put on a mock sea battle in the coastal arena. For too long, we've put up with gladiators fighting to death on dry land. Boring. That sounds expensive. That's the point. It would be the event of the century. We waterproof the arena and fill it with seawater. Then we crew a few custom-built ships with our most expendable gladiators and have them duke it out before a screaming crowd. Alright. Ow, that hurts. So, barons. This is your chance to see how this goes. You are either going to give the patricians the victory, or you are going to vote with me on this. We need to lower their defiance, or else the patricians do win. Ooh, the chiefs are split. One wants to hold the mock sea battle in the arena, the other wants to forbid the arena from experimenting with naval combat. Yeah, this is gonna hurt my treasury, but that's the price we pay. Hold the mock sea battle in the arena. Authority is now iron-fisted because I put a monarch's iron choice on it, because I need to. Oh, excellent. I shall make the arrangements at once, because I haven't passed my check yet. Treasury is now hurt, but defiance is down to grumbling. Okay. Green hasn't won yet. Red still has a chance. I still have a chance. And blue is making a comeback because my treasury is aching compared to the 7,000 it used to be at. A few weeks later, the mock sea battle is held in Thalassus. You watch from the royal box. Two ships battling each other, tossed on artificial waves. Gladiators swinging on ropes with cutlasses between their teeth. A naked spectator swimming across the arena and getting eaten by a shark. The show has everything you'd hoped for and more. A few competitors drown, of course, but that's what they signed up for. The show attracts tourists from across the kingdom and inspires a wave of patriotic peasants to join the coastal navy. A grand success. It's pretty metal. Yeah, that is pretty metal. Alright. Pointless parades. Your Majesty, I worry that our newly built stadium in the coast is encouraging bad habits among the coastal soldiers. They're getting complacent. Too much time is devoted to pointless parades and chest thumping and flag waving. We need fighters who know how to use their pole arms, not just polish them. What can we do about it?
Send me over there. I can toughen up these soldiers again. First step, shut down the damn parades.
By the ninth, we like the parades. They're a perfect demonstration of coastal military might.
So, we can either send the marshal to replace parades with a rigorous training regimen, which raises defiance in the coast. We could actually double the number of coastal parades, or we could unleash monsters into the stadium during the next parade. Let's see here. I am vetoing this. You're not coming after my authority. I'm sorry, patricians. All right, nobles, it's up to you. We can either double the number of coastal parades, or we can let monsters loose into the stadium and see what happens. Let's see here. Baron's still putting up a unified front here. Chiefs? Patricians? What's it gonna be? Ooh, it's even. All right. I know we've got at least one more patrician somewhere, maybe. All right. 3, 2, 1. You're really gonna make me choose, huh? All right. I'm more than happy to choose. Let's double the number of coastal parades. I'm gonna be the greatest queen who ever lived. More parades? Capital idea! Marvelous! The extra parades in the coast put on a great show. Helmets are replaced by fancy hats, well-polished boots sparkle in the sun. Instead of chainmail, ceremonial armor is worn, dripping with gold filigree. It all looks very impressive.
Oppressive.
Let's go. Of course, behind the scenes, the coastal soldiers are growing sloppy and lazy, but who cares? Look at those gleaming boots. Your Majesty, these upstarts are saying they have a right to the claim. Yep. So, I have my heir, and we've got marchers and the patricians nearing victory, and the chiefs are... They've lowered the treasury by a lot. We're down by 5,000 on the treasury, so... Yikes. All right. The Summer Games. The Summer Games have begun. Your royal yacht glides into the port at Thalassus. Anxious servants lay out the red carpet while shooing away seagulls. Ho there, your esteemed highness. Beautiful day, isn't it? Come with me. Your carriage to the grand arena is waiting. What does a queen have to do to get a drink around here? Apologizing profusely, Lord Patrician Killerman 0922 waves down a servant. 30 seconds later, a glass of iced wine is pressed into your hand. The journey to the arena is a short ride over bumpy cobblestones. There must be thousands of people in the arena, peasants and patricians alike. But you have the best view in the house. As you step out and wave, the crowd chants your name. We have two different events that we could show you today, Your Serene Highness. Which would you prefer to witness, a gladiator fight or a monster battle? Tell me more about the gladiator fight. Two of the most fearsome fighters from across Celeste Arth will clash for the title of Golden Champion. Ice wine? So grape juice, basically. No rules, no limits, cheating encouraged. Blood and heartbreak guaranteed. Tell me more about the monster battles. We've sailed the furthest oceans and delved the deepest jungles to bring back exotic beasts for our gladiators to fight. One human fighter's mettle will be tested against a creature from your nightmares. I've made my decision. I positively shiver with anticipation, Your Esteemed Highness. Man versus beast. It's time for a monster battle. Excellent choice, Your Serene Highness. Allow me first to call forth today's brave, or perhaps unfortunate, human champion. Lord Patrician Killerman 0922 steps up to the podium, speaking into a bronze tube that projects his voice across the entire arena. Our gladiator today is a homegrown hero who grew up in a coastal slum just down the road from here. This plucky underdog was imprisoned for stealing bread to feed her starving family. And now she surprised everyone by making it this far. She's here to battle for her freedom. Give it up for Big Agnes!
Out of the circle of sand stomps a massively muscular woman. She has deigned to go without armor, her oiled skin gleaming in the sunlight. Let's go, Big Agnes. Her only weapon is a primitive-looking wooden club with nails hammered into it. Her mouth is scarred at the corners, giving her a hideous, rictus grin. You notice that the cheering for this homegrown hero is especially loud. Your ears start to hurt. Lord Patrician Killerman 0922 turns his attention back to you. Right now, in cages beneath the arena floor, we have three different monsters we could throw against our friend Big Agnes. A lion, a winter wolf, or a troll. But which should we choose? Why don't we let the queen decide, since she's come all the way to visit us from the capital? The crowd hoots and hollers at this idea. Someone stands up and starts singing the national anthem off-key. All right. Let's see here. Troll versus troll. Look, she's big and muscular. That's just rude. Yeah, lion's a classic. Admittedly, the winter wolf sounds interesting. I can't help but feel like, though, that these are going to be from each of the regions. Lion from the March, winter wolf from the North, and troll from the Patricians. And whichever one she kills is going to make that people mad. I want to see her fight a winter wolf. Yeah, it was so uncivilized to call her a troll. It's not troll v. troll.
Ladies and gentle people, it's no exaggeration to say that this beast has ice running through her veins. She's got breath so cold she gave our handlers frostbite. Please welcome Wilma the Winter Wolf.
The Winter Wolf pads out into the arena, its cold breath making the air shimmer before it. Big Agnes readies her club. As Big Agnes drums up the crowd's support, Lord Patrician Killerman 0922 turns to you with a gleam in his eye. Half the fun at the Summer Games is the gambling. Why don't you go to a place a bet before the fight begins? What are the odds? These two are pretty evenly matched, but the favorite is Big Agnes. Bet on her and you'll only get money back plus half. The Winter Wolf is the underdog. A successful bet on it means you'll double your cash. No thanks, I don't want to gamble. Just here to watch the blood fly, I see. That's perfectly fine. As for me, I feel like taking a risk today. I'll place a bet on the Winter Wolf, okay? So, Winter Wolf. Alright. Order that Big Agnes be disarmed. Ah, let the fight commence. The crowd roars and stamps until the entire Colosseum shudders. The wolf lets loose a howl like a midwinter gale. Big Agnes answers with a battle cry of her own before charging head on. Let's cheer for Big Agnes. Big Agnes dances around the Winter Wolf, swinging her club. The wolf's shaggy white fur is soon matted with blood. After that, the gladiator and the beast play a deadly game, each taking turns to lunge at the other before retreating with some fresh injury. Blood soaks into the sand. Finally, though, the wounded wolf goes into a rage. It leaps at Big Agnes, snapping its jaws, and the gladiator responds by stepping to one side and slamming down her club, shattering the beast's skull. The crowd gasps, screams, and cheers as the wolf thrashes and falls still.
And the winner is Big Agnes!
Depths below, what rotten luck. And let's see here. Congratulate Big Agnes. Big Agnes bows to you deeply as the stands ring with cheers. The next week of the Summer Games is packed with entertainment, athletic competitions, chariot races, copious amounts of wine, and above all, blood in the sand. Troll would have been a better fight. I'll be honest, I think Big Agnes would have lost that fight, but yeah. All right. A new contraption. Your Majesty, a chief by the name of AJ the Wither II wants to present you with a new invention. Your Greatness, we are entering a modern age, a more humane age. Yet botched executions are commonplace. Decapitation where the head doesn't come off, or hangings where it does. No more. Behold, a merciful machine for removing heads quickly and painlessly. I call it the AJ the Wither. He swishes away a cloth to reveal a huge machine of iron and wood. It has a hole for someone to place their head and a heavy blade dangling ominously above it. The sight sends a chill down your spine. You... How efficient. Precisely. With the AJ the Wither, you'll send 12 heads a-rolling in the time it would take an ordinary executioner to chop through a single neck. With a little funding, Your Majesty, I can distribute the AJ the Wither across the kingdom. Fine, but we are not calling it AJ the Wither. Very well, I suppose we can call it the Decapitator.
Holy shit.
Alright, I'm vetoing banning this horror contraption. We can either fund a nationwide rollout or test it on AJ the Wither the Second himself. Go ham. Whatever you want, my nobles. I'm amused. One of the things I don't think you'd want named after yourself. Yeah, especially if you're about to be decapitated with it. I got to have one of those. Alright. Voting is closed. Fund a nationwide rollout. Hundreds of decapitators are built in northern workshops and sent to courthouses all over the kingdom. Soon you're chopping through the backlog of condemned prisoners with unprecedented speed and unprecedented mercy. Authority is now tyrannical. My priests send word from beyond the capital, Your Majesty. Ninth willing, it's good news. Listen to the priest's letters. Your command of the kingdom is masterful, Your Majesty. The nobles are in no position to push back against you. Now the true journey of sainthood begins. We will scour the kingdom for miracles so that you can show the holiness of your rule. Please thank your priests for me. Oh, they need no thanks. More than ever, they serve the crown and the ninth as one. I shall write to my priest directly. They will investigate any potential miracles and send word once they find something.
Heads.
Succeeded. After a few weeks, Chief AJ the Wither II arrives excitedly.
The gods are good, Your Highness. Excellent news from the north. 9 white bears have been seen close to a longhouse, and a group of chiefs follow them deep into the snow. There, they found an ancient, forgotten church built into the side of a mountain. The bears vanished, leaving only a handful of fur. Not to mention that the northern crops suddenly flourished. Besides, you must recall how last week the statue of St. Bertrand wet blood after you visited the cathedral, and that a peasant reported a vision of you being blessed by the Ninth. When the Queen's rule is holy, the Ninth God rewards. Everyone agrees the signs are here.
Does that mean it's time?
I believe it is, Your Majesty. I will make the preparations for the ceremony at St. Bertrand's Cathedral. I look forward to seeing you.
That evening, your husband comes to see you.
That sainthood business, Morgan.
I see where you're going with it. But will my kinsfolk really follow you? I've convinced the North to follow me.
You know best, I'm sure. I hope it goes as well as you hope.
Before you know it, the time has come. It's a gloriously sunny day in the capital, and the layers upon layers of ceremonial robes are rather hot. You stand before the Archbishop in St. Bertrand's Cathedral in front of the gathered nobles. The skull stands beside you, his hand in yours. Off to the side, Morgan II is watching excitedly. He occasionally tries to dash into the crown, but his governess retrieves him each time.
We gather before the power of the Ninth Guard to witness the holy influence of Queen Morgan.
There follows a very long sermon. Whisper to the Archbishop, stand and smile respectfully.
It goes on and on.
But eventually, it's time for your blessing. A blanket of silence falls over the cathedral. You step forward, and the Archbishop sprinkles holy water upon your brow. Perhaps you feel something. Cold water being splattered on you. It may not be the most comfortable situation, but you're sure of one thing. The nobles can never stand against you now.
Rise once more, Queen of the Kingdom and Saint Morgan.
May the Ninth God bless this day.
He will, Your Majesty, he will.
Applause rises from the cathedral, echoing in the huge rafters. Surrounded by her red-robed devotees, the High Inquisitor is watching closely. After a moment, she applauds with the rest. At the next council session, the nobles arrive to find a cluster of inquisitors have joined your honor guard.
What are they doing here? Since when does the Inquisition have a place in this council?
By the old gods, hush! Do you want to be tried for heresy?
Sainthood hasn't changed me. The power of the Ninth God courses through my veins! The nobles fall silent, terrified. Maybe sainthood doesn't work like that, but what does it matter? Over the course of the day, even the boldest noble is quick to vote with the crown. It's so easy, relaxing, efficient. You finish early for the first time in months. I'm gonna go to sleep. That's fair, Vimur. Have a good one. With the church at your back, you have license to do what you please, as long as you keep on the Ninth God's good side, of course. A long, glorious, and venerated reign awaits for Saint Morgan. The monarch is victorious. The Baron's revolutionary plans for their new model army were quietly shelved, but not forgotten. These blueprints will surely come in useful someday. The chief's attempts to worm their way into the palace was uncovered, and a number of arrests were made. Chief Glenn 149 ended his life chained upside down to a dungeon wall. All that remained of the patrician's attempt to usurp the crown was a prisoner deep under the palace, clad in an iron mask and shrouded in rumor. Praise be! Under St. Morgan's reign, the church was all-powerful. The only thing warmer than the hearts of believers were the heretics being burned alive. The queen died peacefully after another 15 years of devout rule. Legend says that an angel appeared at her bedside to bear her to the thereafter. Also, though this particular game is over, this game actually does have a legacy system. So, if people would like, next stream, we can do it again. And so, as Queen Morgan, Saint Morgan the First, will, you know, serve out her reign and perish, then we will pick up with my ruling heir, my son, Morgan the Second. Queen Morgan the Absolutist. So it took 3 years and 3 months of in-game time. Spouse was Laskal of the North, and successor is King Morgan II. In terms of nobles, our wealthiest noble was Sanic Hedgehog 420 with 2,500 gold. And our poorest noble was Killerman 0922 at 900 gold. Good night, folks. See you next stream. Have a good one, Vimur. Our kingdom, our authority was 10, stability 5. treasury was at the tipping point for the chiefs to complete their next stage. Of course, it was the greens that both that get both of those. Yeah, I believe Killer Man ended up taking poorest noble because he bet on the Winter Wolf. He bet on Wilma, and he should have voted for
Big Agnes.
But yeah, all right, there we go. So, that will be where we wrap this up for the time being. And I believe that there is sufficient demand for the run back. So I am more than happy to do this again tomorrow for everybody. I am more than happy to stream it again because we can do a continue game and we can continue the Morgan Dynasty with King Morgan II. So we can do that next time. For the time being, thank you everybody so much for tuning in. It really means a lot, and if you haven't dropped a follow, consider it. It'll let you know when we go live for the next part tomorrow. But I appreciate you all tuning in so much, and I'll see you about setting up a raid real quick. So allow me to get right to it.
Surely you've got more meows than you, kitty. You've got more. You equipped the Matrix with TV, you didn't come to the prime. I don't, you want to layer up.